Hello, my name is Neil, and welcome to Redbairn Gaming. Today we'll be taking our previously assembled and primed Space Marine miniature and painting them up to the tabletop standard. By tabletop, I mean it's a reasonable coat of paint that shows the model represents a particular faction and can be identified as such. There are no real elaborate techniques on display in this paint job, so you don't really need to be a practiced artist to achieve these results. All you need is some paint, a handful of different sized brushes, and enough patience to see it through to the end. With that, let's get on with it. To recreate the iconic Ultramarines, I start here with my main colour, in this case Vallejo's dark blue. I could have easily loaded this into the airbrush and applied this to the models over the top of the black base coat, but I wanted to show it's possible to attain a smooth base layer by using a brush. The main secret and technique I use here is using equal parts paint, as I do as a thinner medium and a touch of water. This reduces the viscosity of the paint, but keeps the pigmentation smooth throughout. Doing this does have the downside of pretty much meaning that every colour will require at least two coats to attain maximum opacity, but that's a small price to pay to have a smooth paint job and no lost details with thick globs of paint settling in any of the recesses. I load up a fairly large brush here with thinned out paint and go to town on the miniature. The paint goes on really easily and finds its way into all the details, but because it's been thinned down it dries without obscuring any of the sculpt. As this is our first colour, don't be afraid to be a little haphazard with your application. We'll be going over anything that isn't supposed to be this colour later on. As mentioned previously, I'll need to go over this colour again to ensure an even coat, which can be seen when you look at these models side by side. Two thin coats here ensures that this base colour of blue is up to scratch. With the base colour for our Ultramarines down and dried, it's time to add a bit of depth and richness to this by shading the recessed areas. Of course, we're not going to be incredibly delicate about this, as there's nothing to ruin here. Again, we're using equal part paint and thinner. I use a large brush to apply Drakenhof Nightshade to the entire miniature, making sure to hit every part of the blue I'd previously painted. To avoid any nasty surprises or weird looking spots, it's advised to go over the miniature and spot any areas that have pooled up a large amount of this wash, as it will dry with streaks or blotches if you don't try and mop them up a little bit. That can be done with a damp brush and either wicking them away completely or moving it around the model to somewhere else. Now that the wash is dried, we can see there's definitely a darker tone in the recessed areas, and even the raised sections have been stained a darker blue. To get closer to our original vibrant blue, we're going to use a technique called dry brushing. That's a very simple technique that makes use of a very nearly dried paintbrush that when moved over a model surface only deposits paint against the very raised or edged surfaces. To do this, I make use of some very large, cheap makeup brushes that have a large surface area and apply paint far smoother than if you were to use a smaller brush. The action of dry brushing itself can be quite destructive, so I certainly wouldn't recommend using your expensive kit here. To get underway, I dip my brush into the original blue and then wipe the brush repeatedly on a piece of paper towel to get rid of nearly all of the paint. The less on the brush, the better. Once satisfied that this isn't going to create a massive blob or streak in the miniature, I start moving the brush over the surface of the miniature back and forth over the top and just downward strokes over the length of the miniature. Doing this creates an illusion of direction of light and also ensures that the top of the miniature is brighter than the base of the miniature, which in many miniatures is the most important and eye-catching part of the model. With the main colour of the miniature being all but complete, it was time to move on to the secondary colour, in this case a rich gold known as Retributor Armour. As before, this is thinned in the same way and applied with a much smaller brush this time though, taking care to not go outside the lines as much as possible. As the paint I'm using here is from the Citadel base range, it's got a very high opacity and doesn't require a second coat, so that's a time saver right there. Shortly after applying the gold, it's time to move on to Bone White to block out all the skulls and the gauntlets and chest pieces, along with the participation rosettes, which also acts as a great base coat for the colour I'll be finally using on the seals, a bloody red. The final base coat I put down here is a leather brown, on all the various pouches and holsters. This one definitely needs a couple of coats, as the opacity is far from amazing. With all these similar colours blocked in as a base coat, they get a careful all-over wash with a thinned Agrax Earthshade. If you've been a little erratic with your staying within the lines in the previous base coats, the dark brown wash lends you a hand by hiding all your ragged edges with a smoother transition. Before moving on to the lighter metallics, I take a chance to go over all the weapons, exposed joints and grills on all the models with black. This gets rid of any overspill from the previously applied colours and prepares them for the next step. As with all the other colours, the Iron Breaker light metallic paint here was thinned and ready for use. Two thin coats were added to all the chainsword teeth, weapon barrels and lower weapon receivers, along with some accent parts on the backpacks. At this point, a dark grey is used to cover the armour joints, the weapon grips and helmet tubes. It's also used to perform an edge highlight down the blackened weapon parts. Simply by using the edge of the paintbrush rather than the tip, this is rubbed down the length of a raised edge and applies a sharp highlight with little to no effort whatsoever. Whilst this dries, I quickly go back to my original leather colour and reapply it over the top of the pouches and holster, avoiding the recessed areas to add a bit more depth back to the colour. I also make quick wild stabs at the eye lenses with a deep green, trying to be accurate as I can, but not worrying if it goes a little bit wonky. With the last of the colder dark colours applied, it's time to wash these all with a Nuln oil. Same as before, half paint, half thinner. To breathe a bit more life back into the miniatures that have been muted by the wash, I add a bright auric armour gold over the top of the shoulder ridges, wrist doodads and chest emblems sparingly, making sure not to cover all the previous layers of gold and definitely not going into the recessed parts. Similarly, the chest and wrist skulls are given a layer of the original bone white in their upper areas. There are just a handful more steps to go, but this is definitely veering into the area of diminishing returns. Whenever you feel like saying good enough, it's definitely good enough. For the next step, a simple but effective base for the models is created by using a large pot of Vallejo earth texture. It's essentially a thick brown paint with a little bit of sand thrown in for good measure. It dries reasonably quickly and holds any minor lumps and bumps you may put into it. For this I would either use a small sculpting tool or a brush that's perhaps seen better days. Much like dry brushing, this paint isn't too kind on the bristles. Going back to the original blue, I thin it out a little bit more, so now it becomes more of a glaze than a paint in its own right. Applying this thinly over the top of any blue areas gradually raises the colour back to the original and can be used to smooth out any deep pools of dark wash that were missed earlier or cover up any mistakes that were caused with slips of the brush with other colours. This is primarily aimed towards the upper sections of the armour panels, reinforcing the implied direction of light. Hot on the heels of diluting paint, I absolutely saturate the original leather brown in my palette with clean water, which breaks it down so much it becomes more of an implied stain than anything else. I liberally apply this to the lower portion of the legs in the Marine, which will dry to hopefully show a bit of weathering and a buildup of dirt in the cracks in the armour. The next step doesn't involve any paint whatsoever, but I would definitely recommend having a brush to hand. I've carefully removed the appropriate transfers from the supplied sheet and sat them in a clean pool of water in my palette. If at all possible, make sure you can cut away as much of the unneeded blank transfer as you can, as this makes it easier to apply them to curved surfaces. Once the transfer has been sat in water for around 30 seconds or so, you should start to notice it peeling away from the backing paper. At this point, I slightly dampen the area I'm going to apply the transfer to, and either move the whole piece of paper with a set of tweezers closer to the model, or using a large brush, roll the transfer onto the bristles. I then slide the transfer onto the general area I want it to be, and start wicking away the water and gently applying pressure to keep it in place. You get quite a lot of wiggle room with this, so don't feel as if you need to rush. If it isn't exactly where you want it, add a bit more water and it should move around again. One of the last things to do is add a bit of depth to the base and then neaten it up. Agrax Earth Shade is applied liberally all over and a little bit to the soles of the boots for good measure. Once this dries, it's simply a case of getting our black paint and tidying up the rim. In order to make sure these paint jobs last an encounter with a game, poor transport or snack-coated fingers, it's a great idea to add a layer of varnish. In this case, a matte Vallejo varnish is added all over the miniature. Whilst it goes on quite thick and milky, it does dry to a clear satin finish, which also helps dull down the gloss appearance of the recently applied transfers and makes them a little less jarring to look at. The last thing I do to the models is add a little texture to the base by gluing on some grass tufts. There's nothing difficult here, just a blob of gel superglue and a pair of tweezers to position a grass tuft where you think it looks about right. You could even use them to cover up a part of the foot or base you missed whilst painting and couldn't be bothered to go back to. And with that, we're done! If you followed this style of painting through from start to finish, it's potentially taken less than an hour per model if you ignore the drying time. Of course, there are some areas that could have had more detail added, more levels of highlight, more care put into them. But that's not what this was for. This was to get you used to some basic painting techniques and have some miniatures ready for gaming with. If you found this Hobby Basics series useful, please let me know in the comments down below and feel free to share this with anyone you think might find it useful. Until next time, I've been Neil, and please come back for some more Redbeard Gaming.